Malawi's president, Lazarus Chakwera, has suspended his foreign trips and those of government officials as part of austerity measures to cushion the impact of the recent 44% devaluation of local currency on the country's economy. Lamek Masina reports from Blantyre.
In his televised address to the nation Wednesday night, Chakwera ordered a cut by half on fuel allowances allocated to top government officials, including cabinet ministers. The Reserve Bank of Malawi last week announced the devaluation of a local currency to align it with the US dollar on the black market. The move resulted in instant price hikes of almost all commodities on the market, including fuel and electricity, which increased by over 40%.
I know that this decision has caused a lot of pain, and I know that all of us now have to make big adjustments in spending so that we can prioritize those areas that are most productive and stay the course until our economy becomes productive and profitable again.
Chakwera said he would be the first to make those adjustments.
In making those painful adjustments, I myself have to lead by example. This is why, effective immediately, all of my international trips between now and the end of the fiscal year, beginning with my trip to COP28 at the end of this month, are cancelled.
Chakwera also said he was putting a freeze on all public-funded international trips for all public officers at all levels, including those in parastatals or state-owned enterprises, until the end of a financial year in March.
In fact, all cabinet members currently abroad on public-funded trips must return to Malawi with immediate effect.
Analyst Victor Jipofia told a local radio that President Chakwera would have announced measures that would help generate enough foreign exchange for the country rather than those that failed in the past.
How do you generate forex? The country needs to build its industry that is able to export commodities to be able to be having this foreign currency. Nothing like that came out from the president.
Another political analyst, Georgie Piri, said Chakwera's address failed to outline how the government addresses challenges facing people in rural areas where over 80% of Malawians live.
The impact of this devaluation has really affected everyone across the board, whether he's the president or he is an ordinary Malawian in the rural. And they are not considered in the beneficiaries of the subsidy. What happens with those?
However, the Malawi Human Rights Defenders Coalition says in a statement that if well implemented, the measures that President Chakwera has introduced would likely address the impact of devaluation on the country's economy. Lamek Masina, VOA News, Blantyre, Malawi.
30 people were killed in South Darfur state following intercommunal fighting between the Habinaya and the Salamat communities over the past 4 days. Charlton Doki reports from Juba.
Faith Kasina, UNHCR's regional spokesperson for East, Horn of Africa and the Great Lakes, says armed groups have killed several hundred people in recent days in Darfur.
The reports that we have right now are that more than 800 people have been reportedly killed by armed groups in a location called Ardamata, and this is in West Darfur, an area that has so far been less impacted or affected by the conflict. It's difficult to know the exact numbers, but these are the reports that we are getting, which are definitely very alarming.
Speaking via a messaging application from the Kenyan capital, Nairobi, Kasina says UNHCR fears that as the conflict continues, many more people will lose their lives in Darfur. She describes the situation as dire. She adds that aside from the killings, UNHCR has had reports of widespread human rights violations, including sexual violence, torture and lootings in parts of Darfur that were previously relatively stable and less impacted by the conflict. Kasina adds that UNHCR is aware that some specific groups of people are being targeted because of their ethnicity. VOA reached out to Brigadier General Nabil Abdallah, spokesperson of the Sudan Armed Forces for comment, but did not receive a response. Similarly, Yusuf Ezzat, the political advisor for Rapid Support Forces commander Mohamed Hamdan Dagalo, did not respond to VOA's request for comment. But in a media statement yesterday, the RSF expressed condolences to the families of people killed in Ardmata. The RSF accused the Sudan Armed Forces of deliberately killing civilians while incriminating the RSF. The UNHCR's Kasina says some people who were internally displaced are being secondarily displaced from the areas where they had found refuge.
We are also getting reports that people who were once forced to flee, who are internally displaced, now are finding themselves having to leave the particular site that they had found refuge in because the conflict has reached in one way or the other in the area that they were seeking refuge and protection, and now they have to move to another location.
UNHCR says to end the violence and human rights abuses, the parties to the conflict should ensure an immediate end to the fighting.
We have continued to reiterate that the fighting must stop across Sudan, that people must be allowed to seek safety, whether it's inside Sudan or across borders.
Kasina says the parties to the conflict should also unconditionally respect civilians and avoid innocent people being caught in the crossfire in the conflict. For VOA News, I'm Charlton Doki in Juba.
The mayor of Sierra Leone's capital, Freetown, Yvonne Akinsoyo, has been named one of Time Magazine's 100 most influential climate defenders for 2023. She joins the list of global leaders, including Kenyan President William Ruto, the U.S. Special Presidential Envoy for Climate, John Kelly, and the chair of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Bill Gates. Akinsoyo tells me she is humbled to be recognized for her Transform Freetown agenda, which includes tree planting to reduce the city's carbon footprint.
It's really gratifying when you're passionate about something, you've made a decision to devote all of your, you know, time, effort, skills, everything to that, and then to have other people recognize that you're making an impact. I'm really humbled and grateful and inspired to do more.
What exactly do you do when it comes to protecting the climate? How would you describe the work you do?
What I sought to do initially through the Transform Freetown agenda, and then more specifically through a climate action plan, has been to reduce our carbon footprint. For example, Freetown, the tree town, where we are planting and growing 1 million trees. And we've done that in a manner where we have unique identifiers for each tree. Each tree has a GPS location that is uploaded into our database. And then the trees are monitored and their growth is tracked by over 1,500 tree growers. And these are community-based organizations, youth, who are provided with skills and work. But as far as the tree planting itself goes, it's a multi-benefit intervention because we're planting trees which are economic and with the agreements of communities. We're planting trees on hillsides that have been denuded, where we're stabilizing slopes and preventing landslides and mudslides. We're planting trees along watercourses, protecting our water catchment. So there's so many benefits. And of course, planting trees reduces temperature, which Freetown is really suffering from. I mean, I've just been a function this evening. It is November. Normally at this time of the year, in the part of the city that we're in, which is up on one of the mountains, in Hill Station, it would be cool. We were boiling. Everybody was sweating. And the impact of heat stress is becoming more and more acute in Freetown. So Freetown, the tree town, planting those trees in, both around the city, and this, the last batch that we're doing, we're doing 250,000 right now. 30% of those are going to be planted in backyards. So we have tree giveaways, we have trees planted in schools, in hospital compounds, in cemeteries, in addition to the areas I described before. So that's one major accomplishment. And we have an 82% survival rate, which we can track, because we have the digitalization of the process and we have the data. But going beyond the tree planting and growing, we also have worked on renewable energy and clean cooking alternatives. 82% of the cooking fuel used in our city is wood or wood-based. So if we are determined, as we are, to regreen our city, to increase the carbon sink, which is a benefit for everybody, not just for Freetown, but if we want to do that, we need to make sure we're providing alternatives for clean cooking.
Yvonne, thank you very much again, and congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Yvonne Akisoyo is the mayor of Sierra Leone.
Security has been deployed at the border district of Wundiwujo and Ntoloko to prevent Allied Democratic Forces, ADF rebels, from crossing into Uganda. The development follows a Sunday night attack by suspected ADF rebels in Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo, the incident which occurred in Kichanga, Watalinga County inside DRC, approximately 20 kilometers from the Ugandan border in Wundiwujo, promoted an influx of Congolese refugees into Uganda.